Gamache, and today I'll be presenting my project on teaching Khmer Buddhist syncretism. For my Fulbright project, I decided to use my experience in Cambodia to enrich an existing unit on Buddhist art and philosophy in my humanities classes here at MCC. One thing that I was doing before my Fulbright was to teach some of the very basic concepts of Buddhist philosophy using the elaborate mythic story of Buddha's life and its detailed manifestations in Buddhist art and iconography. For example, Buddha's long ears, which represent Siddhartha's renunciation of wealth when he removed his heavy earrings, or images of the starving Buddha, which represent his failed attempts at asceticism before finding enlightenment. My students have always been interested in why Siddhartha leaves his wife and his young son, Rahula, behind. So it's fun to kind of transfer the story into Buddhist concepts. For example, this great sacrifice he makes by leaving his family demonstrates equanimity, or loving of all things equally. So by exploring the details of Siddhartha Gautama's birth, life, and journey to enlightenment, students simultaneously engage with Buddhist art and learn about philosophy as well. So today I'd like to briefly touch upon some new topics that I've been teaching within this unit on Buddhism, which keeps getting longer and longer. And these have really all been inspired and enhanced through my Fulbright experience, and I'm very grateful. So first, based on student interest, I've worked to develop a lesson on iconoclasm in the temples of Angkor Thom, the temple city of Jayavarman VII. And secondly, and related to that, I've been calling what I've been calling the quote conversion of temples. So some temples that were created Hindu and then adapted into Buddhist and vice versa in Angkor Wat Archaeological Park. And third, I also really do a lot more on this term syncretism, looking at how different motifs or even elements of stories of Buddha's life take root and localize as they move through and are transmitted throughout Asia. And I put that term syncretism in quotes because the word itself has a lot of issues, which I'll get to in a minute. And then finally, you know, I really also focus my classes on these two symbols that are very ubiquitous or everywhere in Cambodia. One is here on the left, the Naga. Protecting Buddha from, like, during enlightenment when the demon Mara had sent storms and rain, the beautiful Naga kind of comes over and covers Buddha's head, and you see that as a really common motif in Khmer Buddhist art. And the other one is this earth goddess who you often see bringing her hair. I noticed her around Cambodia everywhere. And I'll just call her today Priya Thorani. She goes by a lot of different names in different cultures too, but that's the one that I found to be most commonly used in Cambodia by English speakers. I probably won't have too much time to talk about the Naga today, but it's another fascinating topic, but I think I'll stick with Priya Thorani as an example of localization, although in my classes we do look at both. Okay. So I wanted to start with one image that I think really demonstrates how far I've come from before my trip, during my trip, and now after, with a lot of the subsequent research I was able to do, even coming back after my trip to Cambodia. When I first visited Angkor Wat in Siem Reap, the stunning and commanding statue caught my eye. And in my naivete, I assumed that this was Shiva dressed up like a Buddha and being worshipped by Buddhists at Angkor Wat. I assumed maybe it was there originally, since Angkor Wat is known to be a Hindu temple and then was converted later by Buddhists. So I thought it was just kind of this perfect example of fusion. but when I returned, I learned that this is not Shiva exactly, or even Buddha. It's actually a figure called Tarek, or an embodiment of all the past kings of Angkor. So this figure is clearly an amalgamation of the two deities, but then also encompassing the sort of other element of Khmer history, and then therefore emerges as this unique symbol that is very distinctly Cambodian. So, yeah, this is my favorite picture from the trip. I think the reason that even one image can be so layered symbolically is because Cambodian Buddhism is this blend of Hinduism and autochthonous animism, where, you know, certain sites like stones or trees or land areas, you know, certain sites have, they're like imbued with spirits. And then there's also this kind of element of sometimes the worship of ancestor cults. So all of these like a lot of venerated sites that I visited when I was in Cambodia combine different, you know, examples of iconography from Hinduism, Shiva worship, Vishnu, local goddesses, Buddhism, animism, and I just found this endlessly fascinating. So similar to the examples of cultural fusion, like this one that we see today in Cambodia, historically religious traditions in Cambodia didn't follow some sort of orderly timeline. It wasn't as though, you know, Hinduism was there, then Buddhism came, and then back to Hinduism. It's so much more complicated than that, and a lot of it is still really unknown. So it's this very kind of fertile area for scholarship, which I'm interested in pursuing further at some point. Here's another example of a really interesting site regarding my first point about iconoclasm. This is Bayan Temple in Angkor Thom. And the first example of iconoclasm that I encountered was here. This city of temples is sort of like right in the middle, the heart of Angkor Wat Archaeological Park, and it was built by the celebrated Buddhist king Jayavarman VII, who ruled from 1181 to 1220 Common Era. And perhaps he's most famous for, you know, these gorgeous towers. And, you know, people have a lot of theories as to who it is on these towers, whether it's Avalokiteshvara, the Bodhisattva of Compassion, or maybe it's Jayavarman himself. It sort of sometimes can look like that really famous sculpture that you often see where he sort of looks like a Buddha, his eyes are closed, and it's a very peaceful image. It could also be his father. No one really knows, but I think it's kind of more interesting that it could be, you know, just another amalgamation of all of these. But scholars still really are unsure. But one thing I began to notice when I was walking around Bayan is that there's a lot of these examples of Buddhas that have been scratched out. So my first thought was, oh, were they looted or taken or just, you know, they've not stood the test of time, I guess, but in fact, I learned later that they've been removed intentionally. They've been scratched out, and so the temple has this eerie, you know, vibe to it, I think, because of all these scratched out Buddhas, and I have so many other pictures that demonstrate this outside the temple, inside. It's just sort of dizzying thinking about, you know, who undertook this, and then how many people were actually involved, and just the kind of logistics of defacing a temple like this is really interesting to me, but of course I don't think it's actually knowable of how this all kind of went down. The whole temple, these Buddhas have been erased. But what's kind of interesting is that in Bayan, and this is probably one of the coolest things I found there, is, you know, this was originally a Buddhist temple built by Jayavarman VII, so you can almost imagine that there would be a seated Buddha there. You can actually even see sort of the outline of where his knees would be in that, you know, traditional meditating position that you see him in. But that Buddha's been removed from this pillar, and a linga has been scratched in. And a linga is, you know, a non-manifest version of Shiva, the Hindu god Shiva. So it's this phallic-looking symbol here. You can kind of see it being scratched in there, rather crudely. And then, just to add to that, is a hermit worshiping the linga. So this was a big discovery. I didn't find any others like this, although there are others where lingas are scratched in. This is the only one that I could find with a hermit, you know, who's clearly a Hindu worshiper, worshiping this linga. But this was amazing. Okay, before I move on to that slide, I just wanted to mention that, you know, it's now really understood that Hinduism and Buddhism most likely arrived simultaneously in Cambodia. And certainly there's always a political advantage to adjusting the hierarchy of these two for kings and rulers, past and present, to legitimize power. Yet it seems like on a more practical level for practitioners, both historical and contemporary, many worshippers seemed really unconcerned with any kind of purity. So like I mentioned, when I first encountered some of these objects or sculptures, I needed to know, is it Buddhist, is it Hinduist, which one? But I don't think necessarily that worshippers are always concerned with that kind of purity. I feel like that's more of a modern invention. In Ian Harrison's book, Cambodian Buddhism, he explains that throughout the pre-Angkorian period in Cambodia, so before 802, when Jayavarman II declared himself the God King or Devaraja and declared independence from Java or the Champa Empire. It was much more complicated than simply a ruler choosing one or the other. And this sort of tolerance and coexistence can be, I think, better understood as more on like a spectrum, sometimes full of contradiction and paradox. I found some great examples of this. Like, for example, in 639, the quote, veneration of Shiva had eclipsed both Buddhism and Brahmanical cults in Cambodia. And then a Chinese monk and translator in the 17th century confirmed that, quote, the people there worshipped many gods, venerated many gods. And an inscription from the same time period named 90 different Indic gods, 14 Vishnu, 8 Shiva Vihu, or the other example of that would be like Harihara figures. Another reference was to a sun god, 7 Buddhists were mentioned, and some other epigraphical material in Sanskrit. So I think these are really good examples of just how fused together these different traditions became. We know this too, that even as Hinduism and Buddhism were leaving India, they were already commingling with, you know, local deities. They were already tangled together. So they're really, that's something I really try to get across to my students, that trying to dissect out Buddhism and dissect out Hinduism as two separate things, it's not really possible. And so it adds to this kind of messiness of looking at art history. One other example that I thought was interesting is that venerators of Shiva were known to make merit, which is traditionally a Buddhist activity, to increase karma. I noticed this too, 100 hermitages were commissioned and catered to a wide variety of religious sects. And at one point, Buddhists were reported to have bad morals and they were unwelcomed at certain hermitages, so there were like rumors going around about them. But most Shivites weren't subject to such stipulations. So this coexistence, what Professor Paul Levy calls inclusivism, has been present in Khmer culture for over 1,000 years. And I'll shift back to some more visual images to kind of talk a little more about this. This is probably one of the most significant images that I've documented, this sculpture that I found in Angkor Wat Temple. It ties later to Priyatharani. This is a major moment in Buddha's life where he calls the earth to bear witness. It's a famous mudra where you see him touching the ground, and supposedly in the story the ground shook, and that was the moment that he reached enlightenment. In fact, he called this earth goddess in Khmer mythology. It's Priyatharani, that hair-wringing woman I mentioned that I'll show you in a minute. So even when you were to see something like this, I thought this is a really fascinating example, although the head is missing, that all of these things are very like interconnected. So while it took me a while to research this image, maybe someone more familiar with Khmer mythology would see it and immediately think of Priyatharani, for example, since she's tied to this moment in the Buddha's enlightenment in the mythology of his life. So just to skip to talk a little bit about how some of these temples were converted, again, you know, intentionally built maybe to one god or a few different gods, and then later they were kind of converted or adapted by followers in the region, and Angkor Wat's a great example of that. What's really interesting is when you go to Angkor Wat, there are so many Buddhas there, and they seemed as though they've been sort of dragged in haphazardly. What's interesting about this one is that on the very bottom, what looks almost like a pedestal here, is actually the bottom of probably a Shiva Linga, where they would have sort of the phallic-looking, non-manifest version of Shiva dropped into this feminine half, the Yani, which sometimes represents his consort. Sometimes they're actually full sculptures, and later when I visited Bante Shrey, the Temple of Women, I saw that some of these Yani pieces had multiple sort of spaces in them where it's unlikely that there would be more than one Shiva dropped in necessarily, like a linga, but in fact maybe they were sculptures, so they were actually like manifested gods, which I thought was interesting. But here there's a Buddha sculpture dropped onto a Yani, so I couldn't tell if this was an example of iconoclasm. And again, iconoclasm is really like, you know, the striking down of these kind of sacred images, typically done so in like a disrespectful way. I couldn't tell if the Buddha being stacked on top of this Yani was significant, and I asked a local professor about it, and he was saying, oh no, it was probably just dragged in there, and they were just, you know, put in there willy-nilly, which it does seem like that. They're all there doesn't seem to be any kind of order or system to them that, that I could see. You know, there's just so many of them. Supposedly in the 12th century, like 1,000 were brought in. In fact, there's one hall that you can see that's called the Hall of 1,000 Buddhas. They're not, there's not 1,000 there anymore. A lot of them are in the local museum in Siem Reap now, but I'm not totally convinced this isn't a political statement that Buddhism is now won out over Hinduism in this temple. This is one other temple I thought would be interesting to mention. This is Bapuan Temple. I was lucky enough to visit when there was a marathon at Angkor Wat going on, so it was just, I was completely alone here, and a little cat was there too, keeping me company as I walked around. But this temple is amazing. It's been rebuilt, and it was originally built in the 11th century to Shiva. In fact, Paul Levy mentioned that there was actually a gold lingot at the top, but that's since been lost. But then later in the 15th century, the temple was converted, and there's a giant reclining Buddha in parinirvana on the back. So this is another really common example of, you know, Buddhist iconography. It indicates when the Buddha died at the end of his life was when he actually entered into nirvana. So it's beautiful, a little hard to see. It's hard to even have a camera capture it. It's so large. I think now I'll turn to syncretism and talk just really briefly about that. I define the term here because I thought it was really interesting. In an article that I was looking at by Paul Levy that he shared with me when I got back, it's right now it's not yet published, but it really broke down a lot when it came to some of the things I was noticing when I was traveling, so it really, really helped me. But one of the things he does talk about is the sort of issues of this word. So historically, well, actually just recently I was at a conference and people were titling their paper syncretism, and so I don't know that the word is totally out about this yet, but it really does have a kind of derogatory history to it, because the person who sort of coined it, this professor, or rather this scholar Calixtus, he was really trying to unify the tenets of Christianity in such a way that anything that would have been brought in from other outside traditions or any, you know, examples of localization that we find so interesting, these were considered to taint Christianity as though it was like some pure concept. So this is a cool thing I think to mention to students, just to show that this isn't what we're trying to do. We're not trying to find the real Buddhism in any way. We want to look at all the messy details and how it changed and morphed and how different cultures you know, localized it, changed it to fuse with their own existing traditions and beliefs and motifs and stories. So other terms that scholars use are sometimes acculturation. Localization is a great one for students. Hybridity, symbiosis, but still syncretism is the word that you see everywhere, so it kind of sticks, but I think it's cool to teach students about the complexity of the term while also using it. But casually, you know, I introduce this in my class because I want to talk about how cultures change through encounters. I think this is like the most interesting thing about teaching humanities is to look and see how different cultures encounter another, you know, song or poem or a visual motif, and how they kind of borrow it and adapt it and merge it with their own tradition. So I'll move on to this image from Wat Phnom. This image is always like a kind of centering motif for me. Whenever I see this, I know what I'm looking at. Whenever I see a little tiny man walking out of the side of a woman holding onto a branch, I know it's the birth of the Buddha, this like supernatural birth where the Buddha emerged from his mother Queen Maya's side, took 7 steps and said something like, you know, this is my last life. He was able to speak when he was born. So whenever I see this image, if I'm not familiar with the other stories or other myths being depicted in sculpture, this is like where I can start. I know that the story of the Buddha is about to begin here. So this was helpful looking at different monuments in Asia this summer. So I show this to students to try to show the Maya as an example of localization. So here Here's another example of her. Maybe this is a little harder to see, but she's actually up here grabbing onto this salad tree. And you can kind of see her hip is tipped here. And so I sort of knew what I was about to see, the story of the Buddha's beginning. And this is the Borobudur temple in Indonesia. I just had to include this because I found this at the Met. I thought this was great. It depicts these two scenes, the birth and death of the Buddha. So again, there's Maya grabbing onto the tree. And then this is Buddha at the bottom in parinirvana, entering into nirvana at his death. And this is like a great example to show students too, because it's so small. It might have been 2 inches tall. So beautiful, I think, example of a portable shrine. Because that's something I'm really curious about too, is how a motif moves and changes and like who gets to see it and how it influences another culture so much. I think these little portable shrines are really key to that. This is another great example too of the Great Departure. Another motif that I love seeing in depicted in Buddhist art. This is at Taprom, another temple built by Jayavarman the VII. And you always can see, it's cool, this horse is being held up by these little deities, sometimes with little lotus flowers. It was to muffle the sound of the horse leaving with Siddhartha when he decided to, you know, renounce his princely existence. And he left his, you know, heartbroken father and snuck out in the middle of the night. This is another one from Borobudur where you can see these lotus flowers. I just think that is really beautiful. Another moment in the Buddha's myth, you know, his life story that it's fun to show students. So I am able to teach, you know, show them the visual connection through reading the myth. But the reason that I love looking at Maya is that I found that it really ties back to this fertility goddess, this ancient idea of this Yakshi. And this is actually from one of the earliest stupas in India, built by King Ashoka. This is the stupa gate at Sanchi. And here she is kicking she kind of clicks her heel on the back of the tree trunk, and the tree bursts into bloom. She's like that fertile. So you can really see that the body language and the posture of this is really identical to the story of Queen Maya. Yeah, I read a lot about this. I found a great article, thanks again to Professor Levy. It was called Embodiment in Stone, a Survey of Stone Sculptures from Sengal. And the author, Aridendi Ray, explains that the Yakshi is this like auspicious female spirit personified in nature, often shown with trees and water. She represents, you know, the abundance of, you know, wealth, also fertility. So by grabbing the branch, like I said, it really transfers the female fertility like into nature, which is like awakened from its dormancy. So this is in itself is Salabanjika pose. So there's a close up there. And it literally translates to breaking the branch of the salad tree. Here's two more that I found from this great article that just show these different yakshis in all different positions. And these would be really fun to investigate separately. Here's some more here. You know, she's mother, like playful mother. She's also sort of adorning herself. I think they were interesting. Serving sometimes, picking flowers. And then this one in the black and white is the one I wanted to draw attention to. You can start to see Priya Tharani, you know, we'll show her emerging later, but here is this woman sort of wringing out her hair, which, you know, is actually a pretty common motif even in European art. But this becomes really significant later as it's woven into the story of the Buddha, the Buddha's enlightenment. And it ties to that calling the ground to bear witness, mudra. This is also a stamp, which I thought was really cool. Here she is at Wat Phnom in Phnom Penh. So this was actually one of the first ones I encountered, and I just thought, what is this? I mean, if this is at a Buddhist temple, right when you walk in, she must be really significant, and of course she is. This was at the Ministry of Culture. This was at a fountain. Again, like I said, they're associated with water. She ended up drowning out some of the different kind of representations of temptation that the demon Mara sent to really, I think, discourage Buddha's enlightenment. There were all these sort of obstacles put in his way, but what she did was she wrung her hair out, and from what I've heard too from a recent lecture here by Professor Ladies, that the water in her hair represents all the lustrations of worshipers from other lives. So she's using all the water of the past lives of the Buddha to also be like washing away these demons, these fetters. So it's deep. I mean, this is what's so fun about these layered images. And I might just be scratching the surface with my understanding of these. I spotted her at a hotel in Battambang, at the bottom of a spirit house, which I thought was a really cool like amalgamation of things. We've got sort of ancestor worship, the Nagas there. It was definitely the most beautiful thing in the corner of this part of the hotel, but it was cool to keep finding her around. Clearly she's significant. This was awesome. This was a taprom. So sometimes if you can see this, even like, I think the Buddha would have been scratched out up here, but she still remains. She's right here. It's a little hard to see, but this was a beautiful sculpture at the lintel. Again, she's wringing out her hair at the moment of Buddha's enlightenment. Oh yeah, this actually says more. Mara, that demon, sent these three kind of temptresses, and they represent greed, desire, discontent, and craving. So when she wrung out her hair, she washed them away, and Buddha was able to reach enlightenment with her help. And then, so now whenever I see this, I can see the complexity of this, calling the earth goddess to bear witness. You know, typically in books you see it just as calling the earth to bear witness. So I'm thinking that it's a distinctly Khmer thing to connect this to this goddess Priyatharani and her presence at Buddha's enlightenment. I just had to add this because I was at the MFA a few weeks ago for a Matisse show that's up right now, and who did I come across? This is actually a Thai image, so that's a whole other investigation that would be really interesting to see how she's localized in Thai culture and Thai Buddhist culture. It was beautiful. It was fun to see that. The last thing I just want to mention is kind of a site that I went to that was probably my favorite, and because it combines so many of these things together. This is Kaval Sien, the River of a Thousand Linga, and it's a short drive from Siem Reap. There's sculptures you can hike to. There's also a giant colossal Buddha down the road. But what's amazing is that there must have been, you know, this riverbed must have been dried out at some point when, you know, these thousand linga, yani, and some are yani, were carved into this riverbed, blessing all the water as it flows. So I even collected some of the water to take home in a little water bottle because it just seemed like such a sacred site, a really important site in Khmer culture. Yeah, and then this is interesting. There's a wat nearby with a giant footprint of the Buddha right next to this colossal Buddha. It's golden and glowing. It's so beautiful. So, you know, worshippers walk around it. They touch his belly for good luck, leave, you know, dollars or other like objects of merit, like these little Buddhas that are all lined up here, to get good luck and also, you know, accrue good karma. This is cool. This is on the back. People write these messages and leave lotus flowers. But then when you get to the bottom, I thought this was so interesting that all of these different things I was learning about came together. There's the presence of a character from the Riemke there, but then also, of course, Priyatharani is there wringing out her hair. So, you know, anyone who knows the story would see her and know that she's representing the Buddha's enlightenment. And also, the eradication of those like fetters such as desire, greed, other temptations that Mara's daughters represented when Buddha was being enlightened. So I think any worshiper can relate to that. And then there was the Shivalinga. I didn't even realize these were still in use. I had seen them in museums and in the hallways at different, you know, these sort of forgotten Shivalingas around different temples. But I saw a little girl grab this pink bucket and you know, pour the water over the Shiva Linga and then collect it and put it on her head. So we all couldn't wait to try it. We wanted to get all the blessings we could.